This is Captain Cranky here in the Lab-RAT-ory saying there's nothing like the fresh scent of styrene in the morning. Nothing like it.
Everybody, Dr. Cranky here in the Lab-RAT-ory, coming at you with it's a bit more than just a rusty cap update, in part because we just finished adding a little bit of airbrush work, but I want to talk a little bit in general terms about weathering and what weathering is when you are talking about your models. And I'll use the bed. Oops, I will use the bed of the of old borax here as well. If I had to define what weathering is, I would simply say that weathering is a representation of what you see Mother Nature do to vehicles and buildings. And the age, if you say the aging process is natural weathering, then that's also true. We age, and therefore that's Mother Nature's way of letting us know that she's weathering us to perfection. But the weathering is the effects of nature on an object, a person, a building, and in our case, cars and tanks, and you know, whatever your modeling gets weathered. You know, when things are functioning, they're maintained, and their upkeep includes a fresh coat of paint every so often, cleaning, polishing, all of that stuff. If you don't do any of it, then you know the natural weathering process comes into effect. Now, the important thing, if I had to think of one thing that the number one factor that makes weathering work in models is scale. You want to weather in scale. If you weather out of scale, then it's not going to look right. So your wood has to look right, your metal has to look right, the way that paint comes off in patches or in mapping or in chipping, whatever you call it. You know, metal, of course, weathers differently than wood, but all of this stuff that you see here can, in fact, be replicated, but you want to replicate it in scale. Remember that. It's very important. So you want to weather in scale. Weather in scale. So this is our trusty cap that we've been working on, completely dry now. But as I'm turning it around, you're beginning to see some of the shading that I provided using the airbrush, okay? And, you know, I added just a little bit of texture, which you could do, of course, by simply mixing a little bit of crazy glue, just a little bit of runny crazy glue, liquid crazy glue, and some baking powder. Okay, what you do is you sprinkle a little bit of the baking powder in places where you want a little bit of extra texture, and you just float the glue on there and let the glue do its work. Then you come back and you re-sponge if you have to. Okay, so again, very subtle. But it's gonna pay off. I was watching Ron's video in which he was talking about thinking that he had overdone all of that variegated color patching on his cap. And I told him that no, that it looked perfect. You have to remember that you can go overboard with it the way that I do and the way other people do. And then once you apply the salt and you start putting in the paint coats, all of that rust will go into the background and do its magical work. So anyway, that's what we've got going on there. Two products that I wanted to bring to your attention that we use often here in the laboratory, of course, is this Deco Art weathered wood crackling medium, and we use this sparingly, but in this case this is clear. And what you could do is you could do a pass on this, you know, one time around if you want. With a brush, you apply in a few places, okay, and you wait for it to dry. Then when you apply your paint, the paint will crackle. So you could do it in a couple of places. I wouldn't say do it to the whole surface, because that's not going to show once you do the salt process. And we are going to do the salt on this. I mean, the salt, no matter, you know, in all these years that I've been working with salting as a way to work on the technique and improve the technique for myself, salting has never let me down. And it's something that I just love the effect of it, in part because salt lets out, I don't know, some sort of, you know, leaches out, so that it ends up bleaching and fading the paint. And it's just, it's a wonderful, magical process for me, and I don't think I could ever give it up. But you've seen all the other applications we've done to this already, including using sponging. So that's why I'm bringing you, bringing this to your attention. A little bit, you can tell when I bought it, you know, a little bit goes a long ways. This will last you for years. The other one that I'm really crazy about, because it gives you crackle in the scale we need it, this is highly uncontrolled. So you have to, that's why you have to apply a little bit at a time, because it does crack, give you these huge out of scale cracks. This crackles in scale. And of course I have old paper here, which I used for my wood. This is what I used on that bed. And again, a little goes a long way, but this is actual paint. This already has pigmentation. There's a clear version of this, which I need to get another tub because I left my tub someplace else. You know, there's a clear one called, I believe it's called Rock Candy or something like that, and it's just absolutely beautiful. Of course it dries shiny, but that's okay because you can apply a matte finish. But anyway, those are products I'm bringing to your attention to put on your arsenal of weathering materials and weathering tools. All right, my friends, so stay tuned for more on the conversation on weathering, rusting, and making your vehicles look rusty, dusty, gunky, junky, and as a friend would put it, and charty, which is a new word in our lexicon, but we won't go into too many details. Anyway, hope you've enjoyed this video. Post some comments and let me know.